All right. Hi, and welcome to my talk. This will be on Student Picker again. And what we'll talk about is basically persistence. So one of the problems with Student Picker right now is if I start it, let's go look at the students. There's no students here. So you saw me add them before. So let's add a student. Okay, so Abram's there. Abram shows up there. If I return and I go back in the Student Picker, Abram will still be there because Android didn't kill it off. But if I go in the settings and I go into apps and I wait and I drag all the way down to Student Picker and I go force stop and go okay, go home. I start Student Picker again. You'll notice that it doesn't have Abram in there anymore. So this means we're not saving data out. So that means we've got to do something to actually save data. So that's going to be annoying. So in Android, there's three main methods. Let's just see of saving data. Okay, it's not here. Okay. Android persistence. Storage options, here we go. So if you search for storage options in Android, what they'll provide is possibly five storage options that you have. You got shared preferences, internal storage, external storage, SQLite databases, and network connection. One of the easiest things to store is the shared preferences. Shared preferences allow you to store little values, like just a Boolean value, and you can store these preferences pretty easily. So you can also edit them, you can get them. Android provides them at any time. Unfortunately, to get these preferences, you need to provide a context. The alternative is internal storage, so we can use Java file IO and do this, but we still need a context to open the file. All right, in both cases we need context. So in this talk I'm really just going to focus on shared preferences. Shared preferences are basically a key value store that we use to store data. Okay, so let's go back to the app. So what we want is we really want to be able to save this student list, right? And one way that we can save a student list is we can, to save a student list, we can use serialization. So if I just go serialization, serializable. So in Java, we can actually persist a lot of objects. So we can use the serializable interface to basically serialize lots of little shortcuts. They allow us to actually save the data in our objects and save it out. If you don't want everything in your object saved out, you can try to make it transient. So let's see, Java serializable transient. There's no good example here to torrent. No, but transient is basically a keyword. So if you declare something transient, it basically means that when you serialize it, it won't serialize. Okay, nonetheless, what we want to do is we basically want to save this out, right? We want it to load up every single time. So we want to also use the shared preferences to do so. Okay, so what we want to do is basically this controller. What we want is when we ask for a student list, that it tries to actually have the shared preferences. So we want it not only to make a new student list, but we want it to load one, right? Unfortunately, the shared preferences rely on us having a context. So what we should do is we should probably store a context in our controller or have like a context singleton. So what we can do is we can go we can make either a singleton here or we can do something else. And actually the controller isn't supposed to the controller probably shouldn't have access to that. So what we should do is we should probably make a new class. So we'll call this class student list manager. Okay? And student list manager, what we want this thing to do is we want to we basically want to initialize it with a context. And this will be the context that that we'll have access to. And what we also want it to do is we want it to load and save a student list. So we can go student list, load student list, right? And this is going to be public. And we can go void save student list. We can do nothing there. So we basically want a student list manager that allows us to load and save student lists. So what we should do is we should probably start by writing a test. So let's go new Java class student list manager test. All right. And this is going to Android unit test, I think. All right. No, I think there's a... Is there an Android test? Create class. Change to Android test case. All right. So we're going to make an Android test case, which is basically like a JUnit test case, except it allows us to access resources that depend on, say, an activity. So that's nice. So we're going to do this one, and we're going to go public void test student list manager. Okay. The first thing we want to do is we want to, we probably want to make a student list, and we want to save it in there. So let's go student list, and we'll do SL new student list, okay. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go add student, and we're going to add a test student, and we're going to make that student test student. So I wanna basically make a student list with a student in it. And we have to import student. So now we've got that student list and they're imported. And now what we want to do is we want to get a student list manager. So we go student list manager. Student list manager. I think we called it student list manager. Yeah, we call it student list manager. And we have to import it. We want to make a new one of those. And what we want to do is we want to set the context. So we can go get context. Let me just see here. Create a constructor for student list manager context. All right. So if we get a context, we're going to set the context to be the context. Okay. Now we'll go back here. Okay, so we've got the student list manager. I thought we just did that. Public student list manager, public student list manager. Okay, I think we did do that. Save it. Come in here. I'm pretty sure we already did that quick fix. Doesn't matter. So we get a new student list manager with the context, and what we want to do is we want to go save student list. Okay. Oh wait, no, we want to pass in the student list. We want to save the student list. And then we want to make another student list, and we want it to load the student list. Okay, and oh, it's complaining about this right here. Change method to add the parameter student list. All right. Okay, so we want to save the student list, and we want to load the student list. And when we load the student list, we should be able to compare that SL2 contains test student, and we want SL to contain test student. So we're going to go assert true, test student is in student list 2. Okay, so now we've got that test, and it's still whining. Let's go back up here. Okay, let's see if we can run this student picker test. Okay, save all those resources, and let's run and go. Okay, let's go to JUnit. It's probably trying to run. The test student list manager is not working, and right there, it's not saving anything. So what we want to do is now we want to add that functionality. So let's go to the student list manager. We initialize it with a context, so it should always have a context. And to load a student list, what we're going to do is we're going to we're first going to make a preference file, at least this name for it. Pref file equals student list. Okay, and we're going to go context get shared preferences, and we're going to give the pref file and mode. Let me just see back to the web page. Where were we? Cursor adapter. Nope. Serializable. Okay, that's not it. Let's see, where were we? Alert dialog, serializable. Nope. Android storage options. Storage options. Using shared preferences. Shared preferences. Okay, so we can have a flag of 0 in there. Let's check out what shared preferences actually says. Get shared preferences int, and this mode is 0 for private. Okay, so we want to keep it private. That sounds fine. So we'll go mode 0, unless there's a mode private. Where do we get mode private? Okay, it's from context. So we should go context mode private. So we want to keep it private, load it. Okay, avoid magic numbers. All right, so we get our shared preferences. And this thing return shared preferences. So we go shared preferences settings equals that. And then we're going to go settings get string. And we're going to call it the student list. And it wants a default value, so I'll just have an empty string. Now, the problem with the shared preferences is that it only allows us to do primitives and strings. So we basically want to do like, we want to return a student list. If the student list, if it's empty, we want to return probably nothing or a new student list or indicate it doesn't exist. Otherwise, we want to basically return like a student list from string, and we'll give the student list data. Right? When we save the student, this will return a student list. So we got to add this one. Create method student list from string. This will do for now. When we save students, what we want to do is we want to get the shared preferences. And we want to get an editor from the preferences, because that's how we edit. Settings get edit. It's going to ask us to load that. So we get the editor, and we go editor put. I think we go put string, and we'll say the string is the student list. All right, I'm starting not to like this. So let's do this. Static string SL key equals student list. Okay, so now we've got a static, and we're going to go SL key, and here we're going to go SL key. Now it's good to use constants like that, and they should be constants. Static final. Static final. And they should be constants, because you don't want to change them. So the value we want to put in is student list to string. And it looks like we need one of these. So create that method. Create that method. And we convert a student list to string. So we've got two little conversion methods, which I'm going to put them together, and they do that job. Okay, so these conversion methods don't work and don't do anything. So if I rerun the JUnit stuff, it should freak out and not do anything. Okay, now I was talking about serializable before. Let's see, test students. Yeah, so that one's still failing. So I was talking about serializable before. We can actually serialize our student lists. So we can convert our student lists to some kind of data and back again. So what we can do is we can go, we can check out what, what we can do is we can take the student list and we can convert it to basically like a object string. And we can do this using student list is object output stream. Let's see. And so if I hover over that, the object output stream is able to write serialized Java objects as well as primitive data types. The data can be then loaded using an object input stream. Okay, so I can do new object output stream, and it wants another output stream, output stream output. So we actually have to give it one. The secret here is we don't want to write to a file or anything. The file IO we want to do is local. So there exists byte array output streams. So we can do new byte array output stream. And we can put the BO in there. So now it's got that output stream. What's it whining about? It's complaining about the IO exception. Let's add a throws. Okay. So now we've got O and BO. And so what we can do is we can go OO, write object, and we can give it the object we got. It's going to write that object. And then we can, I think we can either close will probably work. It'll flush it. And then from BO, we can get the bytes from it. So write. All right, so let's look at this. This is the byte array output stream. Let's look back at the byte array output stream. And let's go look at its definition. So the byte array output stream has a 2 bytes array. It also has a 2-string. But I think we're going to use the 2-byte array, if I remember correctly. Yeah, I think we're going to use that. So we're going to use the 2-byte array. So we go 2-byte array, and we get the array. We'll call it bytes. Okay. And what we want to do is we want to convert those bytes to a string. So what we'll do is we'll go bytes to string. Actually, I don't think that's going to work. What we want is a new string of the bytes. Okay. And then we also have to convert a string into a student, into a student list. So we can actually do pretty similar stuff. So I'm just going to copy the code because it's going to feel pretty same. So byte input stream, BO, and I think, yeah. So byte input stream, and then the student list data to byte. I think there's a byte array. Get bytes. Here we go. Student list output stream, or no, it's an input stream. Input stream. Input stream. Oh, we gotta import it. What's wrong with this one? Byte input stream, byte array input stream. Okay, and this is a input stream. We should change this to a BI. And this is an object input stream, and this is an object input stream. Right? And we got imported as well. So we've imported it. And now we go OO read OO or OI read object, and we cast the object as a student list. And we can probably just return that, I think. Okay, let me just see here. We need an IO exception, a class not found exception, optional data exception. Oof. Okay, that's a kind of IO exception. I'm going to get rid of the optional data exception. All right, so we've got these exceptions there. What's it complaining about? Add throws declaration. Okay, and what's this complaining about? Add throws declaration. So, what it's saying is that this will throw two things, and now we got to go to our tests. So we're going to do this. We're going to go try, and then we're going to indent all this stuff, put in the try catch block, and we're going to go catch. We're going to go IO exception. E, and then we're going to go assert true. IO exception thrown, and we can toString it. All right, and this complains about something. There we go. And we can do the same thing here. And we're just going to go class not found exception thrown. Okay, and let's try this again. So it's trying hard to compile. It's compiling away. Still complaining, but it throws something else. So it's throwing a not serializable exception. So let's do a eprint stack trace so we can see the stack trace. Let's rerun this. Let's go to our console. It's running. Running. Test finished. Not serializable exception in student picker. So it says that student picker student list is not serializable. And it's saying it's throwing this from 23, which is, no. Well, there we go. It's an assertion there. But it's saying that student list student picker is not serializable. So this is sort of problematic. So if I do that, we see that the not serializable exception is that an object has been passed into object output write object, and it happens that this object doesn't write serializable, doesn't implement serializable. Okay, so let's go back to student list and let's make it do that. Let's make it implement serializable. So student list, we can actually just go implements serializable, import serializable. Okay, so now it's complaining about something, but we can actually quick fix this. The serializable class student list does not declare a static final serial UID of a type long. We can add a generated thing for it. So what this is it's a student list serialization ID. Basically, if any of our data, we can tag that class by that, and then we know that it is a student list. Okay. So the reason is so that when someone else reads this, they'll know what it is. Okay. So let's go back here to the student test. Let's get rid of this text here because that doesn't compile. Save. Let's go back to JUnit. And the JUnit test. All right, let's run it again. So now we shouldn't get the not serializable exception. Okay. Not serializable. What's not serializable? Let's copy the trace. Let's take a look. Student. Student's not serializable. Okay, well, that's not that surprising. Student is pretty simple, so we'll just go implement serializable and implement serializable. We'll import serializable and we'll generate another ID. Yeah, sure. Generate another ID, student serializable ID. Okay. Now let's go back to our JUnit test and let's try to rerun it. Yes, save the changes. There is errors. Okay, that makes sense. I copied that there. So let's redo this. Oh, you can just rerun the failures first. Neat. Okay. So it's trying. It's going at it. Okay. Test students is in student list, is not in student list too. So it's still not in there. So what's going on? Let's add another check and let's be sure that SL2, that its size is equal to 1. If its size isn't equal to 1, then we're not getting the same list out. SL2 size is not consistent. So let's rerun this again. Okay, it's rerunning. And SL2 size is not consistent. So what's probably happening is over here in our student list manager, the string is not coming out right. So we're probably producing a new student list here, right? We're probably not saving it. We're probably not saving it right. That's probably the case. So let's read the help on this one. So, okay. This is a shared preference editor. It's called an editor. And it's got apply, commit your preferences back from this editor to the shared preferences thing it's editing. Okay, that might be useful. Commit your preferences back from this editor to the shared preference object is editing. So what's the difference? Commit, unlike commit, which writes its preferences out to storage synchronously, commits the changes to the in-memory start immediately, but starts an asynchronous to disk, so you won't be notified of any failures. All right, so we'll still try to do a commit, but it sounds like commit is what we want. Commits your changes, performs, does IO. Okay, so I guess what we're not doing is we're not telling the editor to commit. So let's tell the editor to commit that, save that, and let's rerun it. Okay, so it's rerunning it. And there's still a failure. Stream corrupted exception. That's not great. So let's copy this trace and let's get help on stream corrupted exception. Java IO. Okay. Let's get help on this one. New buddy. Okay, well, what about if we import it? Do we get it? Okay, F2. Let's jump to the help on that. But I want to clean it up here because I don't need it. Okay. Signals the read object method cannot read an object due to missing information, for an example, a cyclic reference, or a missing class descriptor when the object's loaded. All right, so it indicates something's corrupted. We'll cut this short because I actually know the problem. The problem, I think, is that when we do a new string, we don't give a proper encoding, or when we get the bytes of the string, we don't do the right encoding. So let's just see if I can see we can do the get bytes character set, right? Returns a new byte array consisting of the character set. So maybe what we need to do is we need to say UTF-8. I think that's right. And then when we go to two bytes array, maybe, do we have a choice here? No. Okay, when we go string, maybe there's a, yeah. So let's go UTF-8. So let's make sure that they have the same string encoding. And let's try it again. So if they have the same string encoding, it hopefully will work out. No, still got the corrupted. All right, so here's our problem. We've got a string, we want to get the bytes from it. But the problem really is that the bytes produced by the Java serialization thing are not really UTF-8 compatible. The bytes are pretty junky. I've looked at them before. They're sort of a mess. So what we want to do is we want to convert that into some kind of stringable kind of encoding. Luckily for us, Android comes with, let's see, I think it's just called, no, Android, lucky for us, Android does come with Base64 encoding. So what we could do is we could go Base64, encode, and we can give it the string. We can forget about the get bytes. We can give it the string and then the flags. I think they're Base64 default. Okay. And then here, when we return a string, what we'll do is we'll return a Base64, wait, no, decode. There we go. Yeah. So we want to decode this one, not encode it. And this one, we want to Base64 encode Base64 default. Let me see. Encode what? Base64. All right. So let's look at this. Let's jump to it. Base64. So we've got encode and decode. We can do encode to string. So let's do encode to string. Encode to string. Change to, oh, there we go. Encode to string. That looks sane. All right, good. So now let's redo this. So the point there was that the data within the byte array, when we converted it to a string, had bad like UTF-8 data, and it wasn't communicating it properly. All right, so that's still not working. All right, so that's a little disturbing. Okay, what we should do is we should probably test this. So I can't test them if they're private. I don't think I can. Pretty sure I can't. So what we want is public void test student to string. So we're going to have this test student, and we want to use the student list manager student no proposals. So what we want to do here is we'll just set it to, oh, this is in a different package, so we got to go public. All right. So we want student to string. Student list manager, student list to string. Student list to string. And then we're going to make a student list. Okay, so we'll just copy those three things. And we'll put in the student list. Oh, these ones can actually be static. So I'll try catch. If there is something, we want to assert true, IO exception. Plus E, and we're just going to go false. All right, so we want to get a string str from them, and the string, we want to make sure it's of reasonable, the length should be greater than str length. Green 0, string is too small. All right. So let's try this. Make sure that this works. Okay, our test student to string doesn't complain, but one thing we should do is we should go student list manager student list from string. We're going str. We're going to go student list sl2 equals that. Add catch clause. This is a class not found exception. Okay, so let's try this again. Save that. We didn't really do anything here. We should go, should make sure that it contains that test student, and that should be asserted true. SL2 does not contain test student. Okay, so let's retry this again. SL2 does not contain test student. Test student is not. So this one's failing, and it's saying that It's not containing our string. Huh. Well, I'm starting to wonder what our string looks like, so I'm just going to run it again with the string concatenated. So what we see here is this is the base 64 in data. So it is converting something to base 64. So at least we know that string is pretty big. It looks big enough to me. But why is SL2 not containing the right thing? Let's go look. Student from. So we read the object and we return it. We've decoded into bytes. We read. Okay. Looks good. So why aren't we getting the same student list? So student list data. Bytes, byte array, bytes. So student list manager test. Well, let's do one thing. Let's make sure that SL2, its size is greater than 0. So let's try this again. So SL2 will be a student list. SL2 does not contain the student. All right, so let's see what SL2 does contain. So we know its size is big enough. So what we can do is we can see if, so let's go assert true SL2, for this one, what we're going to do is we're going to ask the student list, because it only has one student in it, to choose that student and to string that student and see if that equals our test student get name, right? Add catch. And so we've got if there's an empty student list exception. Empty student list exception. All right, get rid of this line. Get rid of this line, save. Let's rerun this. Oh, that one didn't have a good name. Chosen student doesn't have same name. All right, so the name is the same, but it says it doesn't contain it. So I think what we've really found here is actually a bug in the student list implementation. So really what we want to do is we want to see how this contains. It basically searches the array list for the specified object. So let's jump to its definition. True if the object contains it or not. What we got to realize is this is a list, and that list is a collection, and that the collections, they require some kind of equality. So if we go with contains here in the collection, it asks, is the object the same? If it's not, if it is the same, return if it is the same. Otherwise, if lm, So if there's an object in the collection, right, and it's equal to null, otherwise it calls equals. So that's a good question. Does our students test actually, can we do equality? So let's debug this. Let's go void test student equals. Does our equals method works? So let's go student. Let's take that name. Let's call these students A and B. And let's make another name. Student name C. Let's make a third student C with student name C. Okay. And now we want to assert true that student A equals student B, right? So we'll go A not equal B. Oh, we gotta go student A. And go B not equal A. And we want to assert false now that A not equal C. That's A not equal to C, B not equal to C, and that reverse C not equal to A. Okay, and also we want to ensure that, oh, these ones are wrong. It should be equal. We also want to assert true that A equals A. A equals A. We want B equals B. And we want C equals C. So B, C, C. All right. So let's run student picker test again in the J unit. And let's see if student equals actually works out. Okay, so student equals isn't working. A not equal to B. So the reason why A isn't equal to B is because I think the default equals operation is true only if they are the same reference. Otherwise, we have to hash code it. Otherwise they have to be the same. So we got to deal with student equality. So let's go student. Let's implement student boolean equals student compare student. And what we really want to know is we really want to return they're equal if get name equals compare student get name. If compare student equals to null, we've got an object, so we'll just return false. Okay. So if they're equal, their name should be equal. One thing we should watch out for is hash code matters. So hash code's always a problem. See, also hash code returns an integer hash code for this object. By contract, any two objects for which equals object returns true must return the same hash code. So this means that we have to return the same code. Writing a correct hash code. They suggest we copy this code, which isn't really fun. Basically, if we override equals, we should override hash codes. Two hash codes should be equal. So what we can do is we can actually we can produce a hash code from our two strings. So we can go public int, I think it's hash code. This is an annoying thing with annoying aspect of Java, which is that you have to fulfill the actual contracts. So what we'll do is we'll go student plus get name, and we'll say that if you've got the same kind of string, your hash code should be similar. So we'll make a string, we'll return its hash code. So at least we meet the requirements there. So once we do that, maybe our equals will finally work. So it's working away, and well, at least our students are the same. So student equals passed, but we're still stuck with this two string. SL2 does not contain it. Does not contain test student. It's a little weird. Contains. So we'll go to its definition. Returns true if the object is an element of ArrayList, returns false otherwise. We'll jump to that. Contains. Searches the ArrayList. So it's still complaining. Let's go back up to abstract list. Let's see if it has contains in here. Add, remove range. No, it's up here. If object not equals null, then object equals null is called for each element by the iterator until the object is found. So let's go back to our test. We've got test student, we add it, and then we convert that string. We convert the student list from the string. So we have that. And now let's go choose student, and let's make that see if that student equals test student. So now we got the same name. So let's retry that. So student to string. SL2 does not contain test student. Well, let's just make sure that SL1 contains test student too. Otherwise, it's all bonkers. So it runs again. And it still complains. So we know that SL2 does produce a student that's equivalent. And we also know, and I'll show you here, that the student will not actually equal the test student. So it shouldn't actually be the same reference. So test student not equal to SL2's test student. Okay, so I'm not so convinced about contains. So let's go back to the definition of contains. And it's if our student list contains the student. Maybe we got to add some tests for that. Okay, so our issue right now is the containment isn't working. I think we've solved the serialization bit. It can save out otherwise. We can copy some of the tests here, so we can go. We can make sure that the one student it does contain is the same student. So let's see if it does. Let's try with try catch. So we'll run the test again and see what happens. And so the containment doesn't work for that one. And the containment doesn't work for that one. So maybe our contains thing is sort of broken, because I suspect if we do this, we go get students. And then we ask contains test student. Yep. Contains test student. Contains test student. So we'll just do this as a collection containment. Okay, this is a student. Oh, collection containment's not working. All right, so let's not worry about the containment for now. In the next little bit, I'll integrate the student list manager into the rest of the app. This has probably gone on too long with the containment testing.